the archives, and the start of the Institute of Jamaica. The Spanish Town Square is rich with historical connections. Schoolchildren, tourists, and the curious flock to gaze at its old buildings and to reminisce on its history. The building on the left of the Rodney Memorial was for years home for a large collection of government documents and papers. This, along with the nearby records office, date back to a time when this square was first bordered by the courthouse, the assembly, and King's House, institutions and people that then held the reins of political power. The Jamaican archives are today housed in a more modern, though slightly shabby building just behind the Rodney Memorial. Here, the name Clinton Black has been associated with the word archives as long as anyone in Jamaica can remember. In two air-conditioned repositories in this building, shaded from the harsh glare of the Jamaican sunlight, are systematically preserved government documents that date back hundreds of years. Here you will find 2 minutes of the early local government bodies that used to meet in the churches, the vestries. The records of a stipendary magistrate, which date back to the period just after the abolition of slavery. This is just a tiny sample of what the archives contain. At the archives, a team of people work on binding old documents and in conservation work on fragile paper. Here at the archives, Mr. Hudson has had years of experience in this time-consuming effort from the 50s.
Your work here at the archives involves just what?
The main duties are preservation of documents and bookbinding.
What do you do and say you get some document that is falling apart? How do you treat it?
Well, in the beginning, we have to dust it. And secondly, we number it and then pull down. After that is done, we prepare our adhesive to use, that's the floor piece. I get the material, silk chiffon. The document is really sandwiched between 2 layers of silk chiffon, which is known as this material here. And then we use handmade wrap paper to fill in the missing bits. We fill in on one side and we frame on the other side. Mm-hmm. And when that is done, we have it of course, we have it repaired on perspex because nothing sticks on perspex. And when it is dried, it is absolutely flat. After that is done, we have to have it sized because originally paper is always made with size. And in the process of repairing, we have lost some of the strength. So that's why we have to really size the documents. Mm-hmm. Then we have it pressed for 12 to 24 hours. After that is done, we take it out, have it trimmed. Then we fold them into sections. Mm-hmm. We press, then after we sew them.
Government archivist, Mr. Clinton Black.
Jamaica is very fortunate in the way of the survival of early records. A good deal has been lost inevitably by natural causes, acts of God, some of them. The earthquake at Port Royal took a certain amount, though not as much as some historians might have suggested, earthquakes, fires, but even so, the survivals are considerable, and we have long series of records going right back to the early days of British settlement anyway. Nothing survives from the Spanish period. They took all their records away. Every policy decision, every action, every agreement that government enters into or makes or undertakes generally ends in some form of documentation, ends in the form of records, and these have to be preserved. Of course, records have a value also to the man in the street. They define the relationship between the governed and the government. They preserve evidence of civil rights, civil status, and legal entitlements and the rest of it.
The Independence Proclamation of 1962 is one of the archives' most valuable documents.
As well as the archives, another important institution had similar beginnings, the Institute of Jamaica and its National Library.
With the change to Crown Colony government in 1865, new institutions were to be created. To begin with, the seat of government moved from Spanish Town to Hibbert House in Kingston. The new governors, like Sir John Peter Grant and Sir Anthony Musgrave, were in the forefront of the building of new public institutions, like the Institute of Jamaica. The old library of the now defunct House of Assembly would form the nucleus of a public library that was no longer the private preserve of the members of the legislature. An old lodging house, Daytree Hall, became the new public library in Kingston, once again close to the seat of political power, which embodied the library in the Institute of Jamaica created in 1879. From that time, the library began to serve rural areas under a variety of branch and loan schemes. The name of Frank Condell is indelibly stamped on the collection. His long reign as secretary librarian saw the accumulation of the massive collection of material known as the West India Reference Library. At the time of his death in 1937, this numbered over 11,000 valuable items. Before that, however, the 1907 earthquake was to deal a death blow to Daytree Hall and much of Kingston, which came crashing down in a torrent of bricks, masonry, and broken timber. But a brand new set of institute buildings would rise on the same site, with the library collecting and providing reference books of interest to its users, both in Kingston and in the country parts.
We take a look at George William Gordon, who was associated, of course, with Paul Bogle and the Morant Bay Rebellion.
George William Gordon, national hero, was the son of a plantation owner and a slave woman. He started his career as a shop assistant in Black River and later opened a store of his own in Kingston. His business prospered and he later entered politics, becoming a member of the Assembly. Here he made a name for himself as a forceful and passionate spokesman for the poor of the country. He took up the cause of the people of St. Thomas in their fight for fair treatment and improved economic opportunities, and following the 1865 rebellion, he was court-martialed and sentenced to death. He was hanged on the 23rd of October, 1865, in the arch of the courthouse, which had been burnt by the rebels. George William Gordon, national hero.
Some traditions still exist which remind us of our heritage. The Memory Bank records one such tradition. Here's Hazel Ramsey.
For decades, one of our most generous informants teaching songs and telling of oral history and the celebration of Maroon customs is Mrs. Marion Renock. Mrs. Renock, fondly called Mammy, was born in Moortown, Portland, in the year 1889. She died on 15th of March, 86. At the age of 87. She approached Miss Olive Lewin, saying she wanted to leave with her more of the knowledge on the Maroons and their music just before it's too late.
Shantiro, me baby. Hey, 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 Shantiro. Then the men them get together, you know. Coming from bush.
Oh. At least after they finish working.
The devil put a bloody big into the wagon. Oh, oh, shanty, oh. And another one says, blow, Billy Boy, blow. The blow today, the blow tomorrow. Blow, Billy Boy, blow. Me ask the cook, say, what for dinner? Blow, Billy Boy, blow. Sand fly, live on. Mosquito leg on, sand fly, live on, piggy down. Blow, Billy Boy, blow. Mosquito leg on, sand fly, live on. Oh, Billy Boy, blow. Blue widow, Some come from east, some come from west. Me a boo weed. We all a boo weed. These children's school song. But my school song said, birdie sweet, where are you are going? From the east, north and south, golden winds and feather. Yes, so long, soon to be cold weather. You see? Obey is better than sacrifice. You obey your parents. It is better than flogging. Don't eat.
Mommy was a semi-invalid, so her daughter helped her to teach us by demonstrating some of the movements and sometimes singing one section of a question and answer type of song. Mommy Renock was one of the most generous and precious informants and an inspiration to all who worked with her. She not only gave material, but inspired us with dignified bearing, firm yet gently manner, and deep respect for her Maroon traditions. In teaching, she would persist until absolute satisfied with words, music, movements, and meaning were thoroughly understood, and that our pupil of all age would do justice to our precious heritage. Nowadays, we go to the supermarket to buy all our foodstuff. But in times past, many of the things that we now buy off the shelves were once made at homes. I'm sure you never thought vinegars being part of our heritage. But here's a bottle of vinegar made from banana in the tradition of Jamaica countryside. Mrs. Muriel Wins, who now lives in Kingston, is originally from Moortown, Portland. She's the daughter of Mrs. Marion Mammy Renock. Mrs. Wins tells us how her mother taught her to make vinegar, a handy household product.
This is banana. We are going to make some vinegar from it. This is how it ripe. This lose a lot of its syrup already, but you ripen it to this. And then you peel it, put it into a jar like this. When we are in the country, we generally use bamboo giant. And then we take the banana trash, dry banana trash, and put it and make a cork for the bamboo. And then you lean it anywhere you can get the most heat, even at your fireside. But in town now, like how we don't have any fireside, we put it in something like this. And it stays there for a week, 2 weeks. 3 weeks, it's fully matured. Then you get this vinegar. This is not fully matured, that's why it's white like this. 3 weeks time it get brown. Even like how it stay here, it gets brown, and then you get vinegar. What you have in here now is strain off this. What is left now is the sap of the banana. Call it the sap that is waste. This is the vinegar that is into this pot. You use this vinegar if you have a spring and or a joint spring. You can take it and make some dressing for it. You can use it to season the meat or whatever you want vinegar to use on. It's used in any form that you want vinegar to use.
Mrs. Muriel Wins, whose mother is a Maroon from Moortown, share with us some of our cultural heritage taught to her by her mother.
Today we pay tribute to national hero Sam Sharp and looked at some of the things that came to us through our Indian heritage. As a continuing tribute to the heritage, Pearl Wright now presents a floral arrangement with an Indian theme executed through ikebana, a Japanese art form.
Today, I'm using lots of brass because this is a very significant part in the Indian life and in our Indian background. There's a tray, two brass containers, and an incense container. And I've used these together, forming a composition which I will use as a container. So I'm using several things together, forming just one container. I'm using today the bird of paradise, shrimp, pandanus, statis, and Thai leaves. I've chosen these materials with the hope that I will be able to bring to you the sort of controlled dance movement of the Indian race. And for the first, again, subject playing a very important part, I use the bird of paradise, which gives a very lovely dancing movement. It's very airy and very much like the Indians, because they're a delicate race of people and legs are usually a little thin, and so I am going to be using the bird of paradise to give that leggy appearance. So I'll put the first one in as subject. And then, because I'm working behind and in front of a tray, I will do the back part of the arrangement first and then the forward. So I have grouped the pandanus together to continue this rather lovely, airy feeling of lots of movements, and I'm making them more into a fan shape. And as you know, the Indians like to wear a veil, which tend to protect their faces somewhat. That adds a little bit of interest, and I'm using the pandanus grouped together to give this effect. Press very hard into the kenzan. To get greater depth, I add a second but smaller stem of the pandanus. Now the subject is very well projected. I'm stabilizing it a bit more. In the forward line, I will use the shrimp, which will bring out at a lower level the color of the gold in the bird of paradise. The shrimp has a tiny bit of white in it, and that's lovely. It's at times like this a flower arranger wishes she could detach her hands from her body so that she can get forward without damaging the other material behind. But I shall try very carefully not to damage anything. I have grouping the shrimp so that I get very lovely fullness. This is very necessary because containers are brass, they tend to be a little heavy, and so therefore you have to give that added depth to the container, to the material rather, so that the container will not be less than the material which is used. So that's the shrimp. And now I'm using the Thai leaves. They are a little stiff, so to give more movement to them, I curl them in my hand, roll them, and the warmth of my hands will give them the movement which I desire. Sorry, this is a little awkward. Second leaf in. I'm sorry, I must come forward a bit because it's a little awkward. Thank you.
land. Then the second bird of paradise at a lower level. And I'm going to work this in on the lower Kenzan or pinholder. Very firmly, very securely. And to finish, I use just a little bit of statis. The statis will give all the nice feeling of softness which is required. You must always work with a forward movement. Good. And this is depicting our Indian heritage. Continuing my series on
thank you.
Thank you for being with us.
The nation celebrates Heritage Week with several activities aimed at encouraging greater appreciation of all outstanding men and women in Jamaican history, as well as highlighting our cultural heritage.